Welcome to Space News from the Electric Universe, brought to you by the Thunderbolts Project at thunderbolts.info. In episode 2 of this presentation, Dr. Michael Clarage continues his discussion of the Earth's electrical environment and his ongoing role as a scientist on the SAFIRE project. In episode 1, Dr. Clarage offered his thoughts on a recent space.com report on mysterious fluctuations of electrons in Earth's atmosphere. We asked Dr. Clarage to further explain his thoughts on the best experimental approach to investigating electrical phenomena associated with planets and stars.
As the primary astrophysicist on the SAFIRE project, it's my job to design the experiments that will best allow us to explore electrical aspects of planets and stars. What might the electrical potential between a star and a planet look like? Here's one model that I am working on. The Earth is on the left, the Sun on the right. That squiggly blue line represents the rough structure of electrical potential at any point between a planet and a star. Now, the drawing is quite representational, just trying to sketch out the general shape of things. This model is based partly on experimental data from SAFIRE, partly on known geophysical data, and partly on NASA satellite data of the sun and solar wind. On the left, the potential rises quickly to about 300,000 volts as you move away from the planet. This is that fair weather potential I mentioned. The sawtooth squiggles as you move up are those bands of increasing and decreasing electron density mentioned in the space.com article. Then, continuing to move away from the Earth, we reach the Van Allen belts. The inner Van Allen belt, dominated by positive charges, is the high point of the curve. Then, a potential drop as you move out into the outer Van Allen belt, dominated by negative charges. Then we have a long, slow rise in the potential as we move towards the Sun. There is data to support a 600-volt rise in potential from the Van Allen belts to the Sun. I've spoken about that at several conferences, and I'll give you the references below. Putting everything together onto one graph like this is really breaking new ground. Astrophysicists are not talking about things this way. Not yet, at least. This is understandable. Every scientist has enough difficulty keeping up with data in their own subspecialty. It's difficult to be combining measurements from the atmosphere, the ionosphere, the Van Allen belts, interplanetary space, solar atmosphere, and photosphere. And like I said, none of us on the SAFIRE team are pushing any particular model. The real shape of that curve between a planet and a star might look very different from what I've drawn here. This still needs much more exploration and continued work matching SAFIRE data to NASA data and further reinterpretation of the NASA data in an electrical context. Pictures such as this of the overall electrical potential layers are not yet seen in books because most astronomers have continued to assume that charge separations are not maintainable at cosmological distances. There's almost an irony to it because my little drawing is actually the much simpler first-order effect natural in plasmas. It should have been the first thing people looked for. But since planetary charge separations were not considered possible, investigations were forced to look at the much more complicated second-order effects of complex magnetic fields and induced local currents. With the SAFIRE chamber, we are in a unique position to run experiments exploring the possible overall electrical nature of stars and planets. Coming back to the space.com article, I would propose that the phrase "the case of the missing electrons" is somewhat of a misnomer. Calling them missing implies there is something wrong about it, like an awkward glitch in what should be nature's otherwise tidy charge neutrality. I've become convinced that the whole mantra of charge neutrality is preventing us from seeing reality. Nature is almost never charge neutral. And by that I mean if you look at anything interesting in nature, like a cell, or an organelle in a cell, or a tree, or a thunderstorm, or the northern lights, nature is always separating charges. Inside our cells, all the workings of life are powered by charge separations across chloroplast and mitochondria membranes. Bees always have a greater electrical potential than flowers, so there are always electrical fields connecting bees and flowers. And when a bee pollinates a flower, there is a quite measurable and very exciting exchange of electric charge between the two. The more we look at what nature is actually doing, the more we see that charge neutrality seldom exists in any dynamic environment. Coming back to the ionosphere, I would say that the shells of free electrons are not missing from regions of the ionosphere. I would propose that the electrons in the ionosphere are simply arranging themselves as needed. Now, as needed for what? That's a really good question. There was another recent article, a review article, that makes similar mistakes, I would say, in describing large-scale electrical phenomena. This was the press release describing an unexpected Star Trek shield protecting the Earth from killer electrons. Again, there's an undertone like something is wrong, like the Earth should not have high-energy electrons around it. Or if it does, then that's somehow a scary thing. I think an analogy might help here. By way of analogy, you could say that the stomach protects the rest of the body from the dangerous enzymes and acids in it. You could certainly say that. But you need to acknowledge that it's all part of a larger structure. The enzymes are needed inside the stomach for specific reasons. The high-potency acids are supposed to be there for the stomach to do its function. When it comes to studying planetary and stellar structures, it would be better if we all would broaden our thinking. We would learn much more if we came to expect that cosmological structures are performing useful functions also. For reasons that we do not yet understand, the Earth is supposed to have high-energy electrons around it. That is a required part of a larger structure. Just because we do not understand does not mean it's a dangerous accident. Electrical plasmas naturally form barriers, membranes, if you will. These plasma barriers or membranes let through some particles, but not others. We have a lot to learn about that. Our theoretical understanding of all this is still very primitive. But such plasma membranes have been known about for about 100 years. The SAFIRE team is trying to take a step back and explore experimentally some of the basic assumptions about the electrical nature of the solar system.
For continuous updates on space news from the electric universe, stay tuned to thunderbolts.info.